GettingPositiveKarmaNow.com presents Bhagavad Gita for All, lectures by Nalin K. Narula, recorded in front of a live audience.
Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
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 So, Bhagavad Gita for All, we had concluded text 24 of chapter 4. And this is about action and karma. And the 24th text was that a person who is acting in spiritual consciousness, in Krishna consciousness, is going to surely attain the spiritual kingdom because he is fully engaged in spiritualizing activities. He is fully engaged in spiritualizing activities and he is engaged in doing everything that he does to become karma-free. Binding consequence karma free, and he offers everything to the divine and he is dependent on the divine, and so his spiritual nature keeps increasing. So now we will study the different types of sacrifice or yajna. This is a type of a yajna. When you are acting in Krishna consciousness, in God consciousness, in healing consciousness. So, if you go back to text 23, chapter 4, Krishna is saying that the person who is unattached to the material modes of nature and fully situated in transcendental knowledge merges, pravaliyate, entirely into the transcendental zone. Transcendental to the material zone, which is got the material modes of nature and binding consequence karma. So ultimately it is all about freeing oneself from binding consequence karma, and in the process of freeing oneself, one is engaging in the service of Krishna, in the service of the divine, the source of the karma healing energies, and the result is that one does not get material consequences. What are the material consequences we are talking about? We are talking specifically about birth, death, old age and disease and repeated cycles thereof, repeated births. In other words, your karma debits and credits are all wiped out through this process. Then we have text 25. Devam eva apare yajnam yogina paryupasate brahma agnau apare yajnam yajnena eva upajuhavati. Devam eva apare yajnam. Devam eva apare yajnam yogina paryupasate. Some yogis, mystics, perfectly worship the demigods, Devam. And others worship the Supreme Brahma. Brahma agnau apare yajnam yajnena eva upajuhvati. So there are different types of engagements. So people are worshipping the demigods, they are engaging with the demigods. It is very popular and very common today. And there are others who offer sacrifice to the Supreme Brahma, which is the impersonal feature of the Supreme Lord. That is the Brahma Jyoti aspect, the Nirvishesh, undifferentiated. It is like the glow coming from the body of Krishna. So there are people who are offering sacrifices to that aspect of the Supreme Brahma, the Brahma Jyoti aspect. And these are supposed to be done to satisfy the powers that be. So in the first case, it is the demigods who are the administrators of the universe. And then there is the Supreme Brahma, which is the Brahma Jyoti. Okay, I will come back to this in a bit. Text 26. Shrotra adina indriyani anya samyam agnishu juvati shabda adin vishayam anya indriya agnishu juvati. Shrotra adini indriyani anya samyam agnishu juvati shabda adin vishayam anya indriya agnishu juvati. Some people sacrifice the process of the senses, offering the sound or the hearing process and the senses in the fire of the controlled mind, that by controlling your mind, restraint, samyam. And others are offering objects of sense gratification, vishayan, shabda adin vishayan. Vishayan is the sound is coming from the elements, and this is in reference to the senses of the body and the senses that seek the objects of the senses. So this is called the vishaya, the vishayam, the objects of sense gratification. And others offer these kind of oblations to the fire of sacrifice, which means mantras also, which means also the things that people like. So this is for the different, you can say, stages of human life. There is the brahmachari, there is the grihast, there is the vanprast and the sannyasi. So these directions are supposed to be helping people to become perfect transcendentalists, to go beyond the material nature. And these are the various ways that people are doing it. These are mentioned in the Vedas. Then we have text 27. Sarvani indriya karmani prana karmani cha apare atma samyam yog agnav juhvati jnana deepite. So sarvandriyani karmani prana karmani cha apare. Those who are the functions of controlling the mind, the life breath, and the senses. These are all offered by the linking process, the yoga, agnav juvati, jnanadipate. Jnanadipate is the urge for self-realization, and one is offering all these things into the fire of what? The controlled mind. The mind is the yajna fire. So the fire is very interesting, that all the senses, the breath function also is mentioned here, prana karmani, life breath, and others, indriyani, the senses, are offered into the fire of the mind by controlling the mind, atma sanyam. So this is interesting that we are talking about the different airs of the body, like the pranavayu is the upward rising vayu in which your heart chakra is floating. Then there is the apan vayu, which is going downwards, which keeps you bound to the material world also. So the vyayan vayu is acting to shrink and to expand and to grow things and to shrink them. And the saman vayu is the equilibrium balancing vayu. So these are the various vayus. So all these airs are engaged in the search or progress for self-realization. So we have text 28. Dravya yagya tapo yagya yoga yagya tatha apare swadhyaya jnana yagya cha yataya samshita vrata. Dravya yagya tapo yagya yoga yagya tatha apare swadhyaya jnana yagya cha yataya samshita vrata. So Dravya Yajna means things that you possess, that you offer as sacrifice. Tapo Yajna is sacrifice in the sense of austerities, tapa. And Yoga Yajna is the eightfold, the Ashtanga Yoga mysticism methodology. And others sacrifice by Swadhyaya, the study of the Vedas, sacrifice in as recommended in the Vedas. And Gyan Yajna Cha Yataya Samchita, also sacrifice in terms of advancement in transcendental knowledge. So if a person is progressing to get this knowledge, or to sacrifice one's possessions, or to practice your austerities, or to go into the eightfold mystic yoga method and the other Vedic methods meant for the advancement of transcendental knowledge, these are the different categories that are enumerated here. So there is some further expansion of this knowledge in text 29. Apane juhvati pranam, prane apanam, tatha apare prana apan, gati rudhva, pranayamya, parayana apare niyata ahara, pranan praneshu juhvati. Apane is the apan vayu that goes downwards. And juvati means to offer, and to offer the pranam, the upward rising air, into the air that is going upward and outward, prane, pranam. And apan is the air going downward, tatha also other airs, inward, outward airs going up, down, in the movement of breathing. There is the breath in and air going down, and the breath out. The air going out, and in this movement, rudhva, checking, by controlling this movement, pranayam, by stopping the breathing. Pranayam is stopping the breathing. And parayana, apare niyate, ahara, pranan, praneshu, juhvati. So those who are inclined in this way to practice this pranayam aspect, they stop the breath, they go the inward breath, the outward breath, they check it, they control it, they moderate it. And those who are inclined to do this, they do this, offer this, and others stop eating in the process. Ahara, niyata controlled ahara eating, and the pranan, the outgoing air, and the praneshu, the outgoing air, you sacrifice. So there are people who do this breath control, offering it as a sacrifice itself, and the others curtail the eating. So if you remember that Master Yusui, when he was on the mountain, this is exactly what he was doing. He had stopped eating food and he was meditating, and presumably he was doing these breath control exercises. It's bound to happen automatically as you're breathing, because your normal breathing process is inward and outward. And he was knowledgeable in this science, and he was probably practicing this kind of methodology also before he got his enlightenment. So this is called the pranayama system, and this is, as we know, popularized in the Hatha Yoga system. But these are some things that are not easy to do, and these can be dangerous if they are practiced without a proper guidance. So when you're eating prasad, or you're eating food that is got the healing energies of Reiki, the KQ force in it, which is the energy of the Divine Himself, the liberating energy, so the control of the eating is also taking place. Like, you generally stop eating those things which are going to harm your body. You lose the taste for those things. So there is some sense control in terms of the eating also happening. Now we have text 30. Sarve api ete yajna vidu, yajna kshapita kalmasa, yajna shistamrita bhujo, Yanti Brahma Sanatanam. So sarve api ete yagya vidha. So those who are yagya vidha, who are conversant, who are knowledgeable in the aspect of performing yagyas, and sarva api ete, although these are apparently different, kshapita, being cleansed of the result of such performances. So being cleansed of the result of such performances means being karma free, binding consequence karma free. Those are the results of performing any action, is karma that you have to experience. And if it is not a settled karma, then there is a binding consequence to settle in future or to balance out in future. So kshapita means cleansed of such result of such performances. So this is very important. Of what? Kalmasha, sinful reactions. Yagya shishta, by the performance of yagya. Amrita bhuja, those who have tasted such a nectar. Yanti brahma sanatanam, they do approach the supreme eternal spiritual abode or atmosphere. So this is very important, that they help you to, these methodologies help you to get rid of certain amount of your binding consequence karma. But as we have seen, that this is not a constant process, and in the process of living your daily life, you are doing other activities also which lead to binding consequence karma. And the only way really to get rid of them is to constantly apply an energy or a force that can get rid of your binding consequence karma, and that is coming from the KQ force, and that is coming from Reiki and such karma healing energies which are constantly working for, if you are doing that, if you are constantly working to cover all your activities or engage your activities with that service, with that energy. Text 31, Na ayam loka asti ajnasya kuto anya kuru satama. So this is again, Nayam loko asti ajnasya kuto anya kuru satama. So the best of the kurus, without sacrifice, you cannot live happily on this planet or in this life, so what to speak of the next? So that is the question. Never in this planet is there a place for the foolish who will not do this sacrifice. If they do not do this, they are not happy in this universe. So what to speak of being happy in some other universe? Text 32. Evam bahu vidha yagya vitata brahmano mukhe कर्म जान विधि तान सर्वान एवं ज्ञात्वा विमोक्षये. विमोक्ष, लिबरेशन. सो एवं बहु विधा, बाय डूइंग दीज वेरियस काइंड्स ऑफ यज्ञ, वितता भ्रमणा मुखे कर्म जान विधि तान सर्वान एवं ज्ञात्वा विमोक्षये. So these types of different sacrifices are Veda approved. They have the stamp of approval of the Vedas. And they are born of different types of work. They are born of different types of nature, that the people are attracted to different types of work. Some wants to be a yogi, somebody wants to study the Vedas, somebody wants to do the fire sacrifice process, and somebody wants to go to the transcendental knowledge zone. And there are others who are working with those energies directly, and they are all eventually going to the same place. So all these types are approved, and if you know this, you will become liberated. Why? Because you will know which is the best thing for you to do. So at different stages, people are engaged differently. So it is not that if somebody is engaged in a particular type of a yoga process, that is inferior in any way, because for his position that is okay, that is what is suitable, and he should do that. But you can always transcend that level and go to the next level. So there are different levels, and the highest level, of course, is the level where you go to Krishna consciousness, where you go to the healing consciousness, and you stop this business of the demigods and worshipping the demigods and so on, and I will get back to that in a moment again, because there is some very key important information coming from here, and that is now in text 33 of chapter 4. Shreyan Dravyamayat Yajnat Jnana Yajna Parantapa Sarvam Karma Akhilam Partha Jnane Parishamapyate. So Shreyan Dravyamayat Yajnat Jnana Yajna. So greater than the sacrifice of material possessions is the sacrifice in knowledge, of knowledge. Sacrifice of knowledge is greater than sacrifice of material possession. And the sacrifice of work ultimately culminates in transcendental knowledge. So here the word sacrifice of knowledge is got many expansions you can look at. One is the karmakand aspect, where you are acting in terms of knowledge of what is the Veda recommending that you do for fruitive action in one sense. The Veda is recommending. And at the same time it is saying by offering these sacrifices you will become free of the results of your yajna action. So if you are going to offer as a householder certain things to the sacrificial fire, to the Brahmins, to all the rest of that process, you are getting rid of some of your binding consequence karma. But ultimately the better, highest goal is the understanding of transcendental knowledge, not just knowledge. So Veda is got different knowledge levels. There is materialistic karmakand knowledge, there is Gyan Yoga. So the higher end is the Gyan Yoga aspect. And text 34 says how to do that. Tad Vidhi Parinipatena Pariprashnena Sevaya Upadekshayanti Te Jnanam Jnanina Tattva Darshina. Tat Vidhi Pranipatena. Try to understand this knowledge of different sacrifices by Pranipatena, by approaching a spiritual master. Pariprashnena, by submissive inquiries. Sevaya, by the service, rendering service. Upadekshayanti, who will then, the spiritual master will upadekshayanti, initiate you, give you initiation into the jnana, jnanina, of the self-realized truth, darshina, the truth that comes from such a person because such a self-realized soul has seen the truth. So the qualification is that you must approach a spiritual master and inquire submissively, rendering service. And that self-realized soul can impart knowledge to you because he has seen the truth. So that is a very, very simple, straightforward instruction. And then what will happen when that when you do that? Krishna says in text 35, Yat jnatva na puna moham evam yasyasi pandava yena bhutani aseshani drakshyasi Atmani atho mahi. Yat jnatva na puna moham. When you have this, learnt this truth, you have got this truth, you will never be in the illusion of material confusion. Because you will see, you will know that all living beings are a part of me and that they are in me and they are mine. So this is a very important statement in text 35 of chapter 4. And it is something that we need to look into this. We will pause here just now. And we will review what we have studied. Basically what Krishna is saying, that there are different sacrifices that are recommended. And at one point he is saying in the earlier text, which was 25, I think, or 26. Yes. 25. That some of the yogis are worshipping the demigods and some of them are offering the sacrifice in the fire of the Supreme Brahma, the Brahma Jyoti. So I said I'll come back to this because this is very important understanding. If you look at the Ish Upanishad, if you look at the text Mantra 12, the Ish Upanishad is the law book. It's got only 18 mantras, 18 shlokas. And this is the law book. It is a synoptic form of exactly the most core instructions of the Divine. And the 12th mantra is Andham Tama Pravishanti Ye Asambhutam Upasate Tata Bhuya Eva Tama Yeu Sambhuitam Rata. Andham, ignorance, Tama, darkness, Pravishanti, they enter those who worship the demigods. Think about that. Those who worship the demigods enter into the darkest region of ignorance. And even more so are those who enter the worship of the Supreme Absolute Brahmjyoti aspect, the effulgence. So that is the impersonal merging into the Divine, Brahmaleen aspect, where you want to become part of the Divine so that you become the Divine, the expanded false ego in the most tremendous way. I will merge into the Divine and therefore become the Divine. That is the gravest of all darknesses. And one step removed below that is the worship of the demigod. So it is absolutely forbidden in the core understanding that this is all right. The Vedas are saying, even the Vedas are saying that, you know, you should not get into the demigods. This is text 25 of chapter 4 of the Bhagavad Gita says, don't do it. Mantra 12 of the Ish Upanishad says, don't do it because this is where you're going to end up. And this is not a place that you want to be in. So, it is, Mantra 13 of the Ish Upanishad says that you will get a different result depending on what you are approaching, who you are approaching. Krishna says that also in the Bhagavad Gita, that if you approach the demigods, you will get a different result. If you approach me, you will get a different result. He says, you have all kinds of problems, don't go to the demigods, come to me. That is the biggest illusion. So this is something that you have to get rid of. So there is no question of going and getting engaged in worshipping demigods, because they can't give you what Krishna can give you. We have discussed this throughout various aspects of this understanding in the previous shlokas, in the previous readings of the Bhagavad Gita. But here this is very, 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 very clear. There's no room for doubt. No demigod worship for those who are serious about getting to the end goal. Even those who are not so serious, Vedas are saying, don't worship the demigods. You do the yajnas, do everything. They are the demigods, are the facilitators, but you don't start sucking up to them. It's like you have a bank account which has certain things in it which you have put in, and you start sucking up, or you start, you know, appropriating the bank, you know, the bank officials. They can't give you more than what's in your account. So it doesn't make any sense to go around and, you know, worship the demigods. That is going to give you a very different result. That's going to give you a result which will keep you bound up in fear, is going to keep you bound up in anxiety, and you will not be able to go beyond the illusion. So which is what was happening earlier also in some sense. A lot of fear had been generated because of this, and you run to this demigod, do this puja, do this sacrifice. Yes, that is meant for a very different type of a person. That they will, and all of those at a certain level are fine. The Vedas recommend that you go and do certain yajnas where you invoke the demigods who will help you. But it's not that you are supposed to worship them as the Supreme, or you are supposed to worship the Brahmjyoti as the Supreme. So this is very, very important to understand this. And finally, the bottom line here is that one should approach the spiritual master a self-realized soul who can give you the initiative into this knowledge, and he can initiate you into the transcendental zone and remove your ignorance, because he has seen the truth himself. So such a self-realized soul can impart this knowledge to you because he has seen the truth. It's not theoretical. Text 34. Tad viddhi pranipatena pariprashnena sevaya upadekshayanti te jnanam jnaninastattva darshina. He has seen it, touched the truth directly. Tattva. The essence, the essential. So that is self-realization. To directly touch the truth, to directly perceive it, not theory, not illusion. And then text 35, so when you know this truth, you will know that all living beings are but part of me, and they are in me and they are mine. So we know this from the teachings of Reiki, that Reiki is in every living individual. Reiki is source, is the divine, supreme himself, Lord Krishna eventually, and then it descends downward, and it is in every living entity. So when you know this truth, you actually know this. So when you have the fifth principle of Reiki, just for today, I shall respect my parents, my elders, my teachers, and all living entities, including myself. This is what it means. That is the synoptic form of what Krishna is telling Arjun here directly. So this is absolutely perfect correlation, that when you know this truth, you will be liberated. Why? Text 36. We will conclude here today. Even if you are, the text is, api ched asi papebhya sarvebhya papakritatama sarvam jnana plavaneva vrijinam santarishyasi api cheta papebhya. If you are the most rotten of all sinners, worst sinful person, sarvebhya, all papakritama, worst, lowest form of sinner, sarvam, all such sinful reactions, jnana plavena, by the vehicle or the boat of transcendental knowledge, eva vrijanam, you will certainly cross over the material ocean of miseries, santarishyasi, you will cross completely. Jnana plavena eva vrijanam, the ocean of miseries, with this knowledge, jnana, of transcendental knowledge boat, you will cross over vrijanam, the ocean of miseries, santarishyasi, completely you will cross it over. So this is, well, we should actually continue to the next shloka because it is going so nicely in the continuity. Text 37. Yatha e dhamsi samiddha agni bhasmasat kurute arjuna jnana agni sarvakarmani bhasmat kurute tatha. Just as the blazing fire turns the firewood to ashes, so does the fire of knowledge, this transcendental knowledge, jnanagni, burn to ashes all reactions to material activity. So again, karmic consequences. This is the bottom line. So when you cultivate transcendental knowledge, when you cultivate it in this way, what is the way you have to approach a spiritual master? You cannot get out of it. You may do your own independent studies, that's fine, but you're not approaching a spiritual master who can impart it to you by his touch, by his sight, by his vision, by his presence. So therefore the spiritual master is very, very needed. And as we learn from the understanding of the KQ, that the higher crown chakra, the highest crown chakra are the two. There is your own crown chakra, which is where you live. Above that is the spiritual master, and then above that is the divine. So the spiritual master chakra is the link between the divine and you. So you cannot jump over. Even in the Vedas it says jumping over the spiritual master is offense. You cannot jump over the spiritual master and go to the divine. You may claim you have your independent relationship, but you don't have an independent relationship. You have a dependent relationship, because it is only one way till you get initiated. then it becomes two-way. That is the difference. So this is text 37. There's a lot more interesting stuff coming up, but I think we will pause here for today, text 37, because this is a reasonable point to conclude today. Actually, we can continue to the next shlok, text 38, because it's some very nice information. So, nahi jnanena sadrisham pavitram iha vidyate tat svayam yoga sansiddhi kalenatvani vindati. So there is nothing so sublime in this world and so pure as this transcendental knowledge, and this knowledge is the mature fruit of mysticism. So all the mystic yogas you are practicing, this is the ultimate fruit that you get to. And if you are getting there directly, bypassing all the other things, you are saving a lot of time and a lot of births. And one who has achieved this enjoys the self within himself in due course of time. So it's a process. Kalena. Kalena Atmani Vindati. Samsiddhi. Matured. Samsiddhi Kalena Atmani Vindati. So the person enjoys this yoga, this devotion, in time. So it's a practice. So that is why you have to practice this. Okay. So this is such a wonderful exposition. In text 39, Krishna says, Shraddhava labhate jnanam tatpara samyatendriya jnanam labdhva param santim achirnadhigacchati. So Shraddhavan labhate jnanam para sansaya indriya jnanam labdhva param shantim achirina adhigachati. So such a faithfully shraddhavan, faithfully following person achieves knowledge and gets very attached to that process, that system, and by controlling his senses and controlling these tendencies that he has towards the vishaya, the objects of the senses. So when you control the senses, they are not running after the objects. So having achieved this, then the person achieves param shantim, transcendental peacefulness, achirena, very soon, adhigacchati, he attains this very, very quickly. So of course, you also, if you add on the sound vibration of the Maha Mantra, the Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare chanting, that will also be very, very helpful. So we might as well finish this chapter because there's just two shlokas left. So we've gone very well with this. Then we have text number 40. Agyasch Chashraddhanascha samyasyatma vinashyati nayam loko asti na paro na sukham samseyatmana. Agya fools, agya fools, cha ashraddhana, those who have no faith in the revealed scriptures, and also the doubtful persons, they do not attain God consciousness. They do not attain this understanding. They do not attain this happiness. But when they are in this process, for them there is no happiness either in this world or the next. So previously Krishna had told Arjun this a few shlokas back. He had mentioned that people who are like this, they don't go get any happiness in this world or the next. They'll never be happy. And this is the reality of such people. So text 41. Yoga sanyasta karmanam jnana sanchinna samshayam atmavantam na karmani nibadhananti dhyananjaya. So this devotional service, karma yoga aspect, sanyas karmanam, you are renouncing, those who have renounced the fruits of your action. How do you renounce the fruits of your action? By saying, I don't want the binding consequence karma, I don't want the results of my karma, And that, when you do your healing, you are saying, I don't want the results. I want the matter to end today. I want it to become a karma, that there are no future consequences for me, whose doubts are destroyed by transcendental knowledge, and who is firmly situated in the self, the energy of the self, which is the soul self, the flow of the healing energy. And he is not bound by works. Dhananjaya. Dhananjaya means one who has conquered riches. So such a person who is firmly situated in the self is not bound by any works. What is bound by any works mean? Binding consequence of your actions. That's another word. So Atmavantam na karmani nibhadananti. Karmani nibhadananti is not bound up by work. So binding consequence karma is not there at all. And that is again and again repetitively what Krishna is saying. You have to get rid of binding consequence karma. And the way to do it is to work directly with the spiritual master who will convey this to you. And by having this knowledge and working in the system of freeing yourself from binding consequence karma, will you be free. Not by doing one yajna once a year, not by doing one fire sacrifice once a year, or running after demigods all the time, or whatever you want to do. That's not there, because you must cultivate transcendental knowledge. Then, text 42, Tasmat ajnana sambhutanam hritstham jnanasinatmana chittavainam sanshayam yogam adhishthotishtha bharata. Tasmat ajnana sambhutam hritstham jnana ashina atma chitva, cutting off, enam sanshayam, doubt, cut out the doubt. Therefore, the outcome of ignorance situated in the heart, you cut out by the weapon of knowledge of the self. That is your weapon, knowledge of the self, transcendental knowledge of the self. And by this, cut out all doubts and be engaged in linking in yoga. Be situated in it. Yogam athishtha, utthishtha, stand up to fight, Bharata. So Krishna is telling him, armed with this yoga, stand up and fight. So this is an instruction for us. When you have this, only can you stand up and fight against all that you are facing in life. Don't give up. Don't follow the conventional so-called easy way. Everybody is going to hell. I will also go to hell. They are worshipping demigods. I have to worship the demigods. Otherwise, some great disaster will befall me. If I do not do my Navratras, Devi is going to beat me with a stick. No, not at all. Nothing like that is ever going to happen to you. So you have to be fearless. You have to be strong, and you have to be knowledgeable. So this is the key. Absolute key. One who has renounced the fruits of his actions. One who has renounced, I don't want binding consequence karma, whose doubts are destroyed by transcendental knowledge, by approaching the spiritual master, by hearing submissively and being of service, who is situated firmly in the self, in that energy, in that flow of healing energy, and is not bound by works. That person is not bound by works. And he has all the riches available. He is considered to be a very wealthy person because he has no debt. He has no karmic debt, and he is attaining to the spiritual, attaining to the divine. So that is the end of chapter 4 of the Bhagavad Gita as it is. Okay. Next time we will review this a little bit before we go on to chapter 5. So, this is all about knowledge, action, and transcendental knowledge and transcendental action. If there are any questions, I will take them today. Who? Yes. Volume nahi aa raha. Sound is very, very dim. Can you? Yeah, no, I heard something, but I. Yes, that's good. Yes, I can hear you. go ahead. Please speak. No, you're breaking up. Are you on a cell phone? Can't hear you now. Anu cannot hear you now. Maybe she can type a question.
I've just sent a message to type
it. Yeah, can type a question.
So, sir, this is a process. Even we are as a healer also, it's a process.
Yes.
So there are maybe still there are certain sacrifices involved.
Like what?
See, like controlling the mind.
Yeah, you have to control the mind. That is the sacrifice you offer to the fire of the mind. You have to control the mind, and with controlled senses, then you cultivate this knowledge and be with the energy, with the force that is within. So the within force is the heart energy, which is the Reiki energy, the KQ force energy, the internal spiritual energy. So in time you will get to enjoy that and be satisfied with that. Krishna says it takes time for you to be satisfied eventually, because we've got so many bad tastes and habits over time that they will take time to change once you follow the practice, the method. So this is knowledge coming down from millions of years back. The same knowledge is applicable even today. Yes, Sabrina. Yes. If you don't have debts, aren't you rich? Then, suppose you have no debts whatsoever. Never came with so much of force. Okay. So there is clarity now. Yeah. So that's the only time then you can actually be free to act. When you are free of these karmic consequence debts. The more free you become of these debts, the freer you are internally, the more happy you will be internally. When you are running around trying to pacify the demigods or satisfy them or, you know, bribe the demigods, Krishna is saying, don't do it. Ishopanishad is saying the worst possible thing you can do. Because you are giving them position equal to God or equal to Krishna. Yes, they are very revered seniors and helpers and administrators of the universe. But if you go to the Ish Upanishads, even the demigods can't approach divine. Actually, I will read you that shloka. It is scary. The demigods can't approach Krishna. They have to go through Brahma. I think that is text 12. Text 12 was, of course, of the Ish Upanishad, that those who engage in the worship of demigods enter into the darkest region of ignorance, and still more so do those who enter the who worship the Brahmajyoti, the Brahmlin aspect. You want to become the supreme absolute glow. And see. Remember reading a shlok here. So here, if you go again, you know, Krishna is saying those who are having this knowledge know that they are all a spark of me and they are mine and so on. And in Mantra 7 of the Ish Upanishad, exactly the same thing is said. One who always sees all living entities as spiritual sparks in quality one with the Lord becomes a true knower of things. So there, where is the illusion? Where is the anxiety? So once you know that they are actually know that everything is coming from Krishna, they all have the same qualities, including in other people, there is no anxiety. There is no illusion. So the matter is, again, Mantra 6 of the Ish Upanishad. The person who sees everything in relation to the Supreme Lord and sees all living entities as his parts and parcels, sees the Supreme Lord within everything, never hates anything nor any being. There's no hatred, but certainly you take whatever action you need to take. So if you read these 18 mantras of study this Ish Upanishad, it's very nicely explained by Bhaktivedanta Swami in great detail. But I mean, see the correlation. I mean, this is perfect exposition of what is transcendental knowledge. And you know, of chapter 4, you can say that this is a summary of chapter 4, the Ish Upanishad, and that is actually the law book of mankind, supposed to be. Of course, there are other knowledge also, but these 18 mantras are superb understanding and guidance. And somewhere I remember reading here, I'm just trying to locate that shlok, that the demigods actually cannot approach the divine directly also. So, let's see if I can find that shlok. Text 4. The personality of Godhead, although fixed in his abode, is more swift than the mind and can overcome all others who may travel at their swiftest speed. So none of the devtas, the powerful demigods, cannot approach him. Deva, let me say, anejat ekam manasa javiya noenat deva apnuvan purvam. But because the Supreme is swifter than the mind, the movement of the mind, deva, the demigods, cannot approach. But of course, further down the line, those who cultivate this transcendental knowledge can. So we have to understand, even the demigods really are in a lot of lack of knowledge of who the divine is. So they are also... Indra was completely an illusion. He is the king of heaven, of Indralok. He did not know who Krishna is. For him, you know, the Supreme was Brahma and possibly Vishnu. That is the thing. So,
Anand has written.
Yes, what is the question?
He says, if reaching the Guru is a big step in progress, how do we stop people from falling off and staying and continuing on the path?
By cultivating the knowledge, by continuing your process, and by association. If you do not associate with the Guru, you are going to go away. At some point, you will be swayed. So, the next best is that, you know, you connect with the teachings of the Guru and you stay within the community of the healers. This is what we have been building for the last over so many years, and now it is showing some result that, you know, the healers are coming together and they are free of this anxiety and this fear, and the falling away is going to take place because of all ego considerations and disrespecting the Guru and not understanding the position of the Guru. So it is very difficult to understand, because Guru may act like an ordinary person, you do not know. So the only way you will come to know is by the teachings. If the teachings are only confirming your own biases and illusions, you are not going to get anywhere very far. If the teachings are only going to cultivate fear and propagate more fear and anxiety in you, and you will be controlled by the Guru in that way, then that is not the Guru. That is a fear-mongering controller.
She says, how we help those who have already fallen?
send healing to them, that's all you can do. They are not going to listen. They have to burn first. They have to burn in the fire of material pain before they come to some understanding. And right now they are under anesthesia. They are thinking everything is fine. Because the false ego is so powerful. So they are anesthetized because of their false ego. The false ego is giving them anesthesia. Yes, yes, this is good. You can study all this on your own. You call one Sanskrit teacher and he will teach you this, and you have read so many books and you have understood so many things, and what is there, and you can hold a, you know, theoretical scholarly discussion with someone. But you are a damn fool according to Krishna. Even according to Bhagavad, Ishopanishad, you are an idiot. If that's how you are thinking. Because you have to sacrifice knowledge also. Krishna says in this, you have to sacrifice this knowledge, the book knowledge, for the transcendental knowledge. Srimad Bhagavatam is the study of Vedanta. What is Vedanta? Vedanta is the ant of Vedas. Where the Vedas end, the Bhagavatam starts. That is true transcendental knowledge. Because Vedas are dealing mostly with this material aspect. How to engage people who are materially bound in improving themselves. That is the teaching of the Vedas for all types of people who are in the material zone, who are bound in this material aspect, how to improve them. But Vedanta is Reiki. Vedanta is the KQ force. And the healers who are practicing this, they are true Vedantists. The others are fooling around. Okay. Let them be. Don't disturb them. Let them do what they have to do. Because the first rule is, if somebody is following a particular path, they are following it according to their capability. They are not capable of following this. You can't do anything. You can send healing. They may elevate themselves at some point. Fine. Leave them alone. You will find plenty of people who are ready to climb out from the hole of ignorance and hole of darkness. Those people you can help. Those who are going deep into the tunnels, you're not going there. No need. You help those who can be helped. Again, there are 10 people who are wounded. Those you can save, have a good chance or better chance of saving, try to save those first. The ones who are savable, you should save those. Not savable, we wish them well. Send them healing. God bless you. Tata, bye-bye. That's what you tell them. Stay away from them. Because they will pollute you and contaminate your thinking also. So this polluted thinking will also happen. And it's infectious. It's very easy, yes. So many wrong things. Yeah. So you look at it from the material angle. And you will go further and further into darkness. Absolutely. Connecting on the webinar is absolutely connecting with the Guru. Definitely. This is as good as association. This is association. Definitely. Any other questions? Yes.
Sir, before we were connected to Reiki and the KQ force, and we had only a one-way connection, you said?
Yeah, everyone who is not initiated has only a one-way connection, which is downward. You don't have a reciprocal upward connection. You cannot connect in the ways that you connect now. Could you? You couldn't. With the healing energy, with the flow of energy, because the energy flow was not available to you to connect in that way. Although it was there, but it was not there in that quantum, it was not there in that connectivity. It's not there. Okay. Anything else? Who?
Bhavani.
Bhavani, okay.
She says, please offer my gratitude to the Master for this amazing blessing of a lifetime. It's like $1 million.
Okay, wonderful. Yes, so that is the riches that you have. A person who is karma debt-free, he is a rich man.
Yes, so grateful.
Okay, God bless. I think we'll conclude here today. We included this wonderful chapter 4 of Bhagavad Gita. ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय
ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय
ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय
ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय
ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय
ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय।
You've been listening to Nalin Kanarula on Getting Positive Karma Now.com.